It's a pity that this world is the way that it is, because beautiful night like this, the crickets just chirping, it's just incredible. And yet, so many problems, seemingly unsolvable, everywhere. Extreme stress and all that. It's a pity. It's really a pity, isn't it? But this is the storyland. We live in the storyland of all these storylines, all of these storylines, and every single storyline there is or ever will be is actually an expression of our desire to be separate from God. And they express in some way the basic theme of there is something outside of reality, outside of God, and that we're aware of it and God isn't. And so we're trying to find this, bring it in, arrive at it, have it, welcome it, have it reach reality so we can say, see God, there really was something beyond every awareness. And you didn't know it, we did. We're greater than you. We're greater than you. Excuse me. We're greater than you, God. So our attention is on all these storylines in this world. And following them, saying, yeah, this is significant, this is significant. But truly there is no arrival, no getting, no reaching anything, no attaining anything, no attainment whatsoever, not even attainment of enlightenment. There isn't anything beyond endlessness, boundlessness. There isn't anything beyond boundlessness, beyond everywhereness. There is not, there is not. This is just a fantasy, a game that we're playing. It's possible to shift your attention off of the plot of this world, all the plots, the plot of the movie, and like attainment. Where's the, you know, all this attainment and reaching and arriving and grasping and getting. Take your attention off of the plot, and then you realize everything's already here. Everything's already here. There's nothing outside. All these storylines are already here. They're not outside. The storyline of being outside, of the outside reaching the inside, that whole storyline is in within the boundlessness. It's already all within the boundlessness already. Nothing that has to happen. You don't have to follow any of the storylines. It doesn't matter in the slightest bit what happens to any of these storylines, actually. Don't need to make them better, don't need to make them worse, don't need to adjust anything. Nobody needs to adjust anything, as a matter of fact, right this instant. That's the vision of oneness. Now I reach this realization in at least a rudimentary form on the morning of July 17th. That is true, the morning of July 17th. And today is, what, the 19th? So I let it sink in. I let it sink in. And I'm just a raw rookie. Just a raw rookie called up to the big club, big leagues. And I'm just, you know, like, wow. Just staying humble and low and lowly and just, okay. And I was able to see this, that the attention, shifting the attention, just a shift of attention. And you realize everything, as it is right now, is doesn't need to be adjusted. Nothing needs to be adjusted. Do not adjust your set. You don't need to. No one needs to be anything different than what they are this instant, actually, because it doesn't matter. There isn't. Everything right now is already perfectly included in the boundless everywhereness. So nothing has to happen. Nothing needs to happen. Nothing needs to happen at all. reality has no needs. Reality doesn't need anything to happen. A happening means a process, like an arrival, an attainment, a welcoming, an inclusion, something happening that isn't already part of reality, one with reality. Doesn't need anything to happen. Reality is already perfect. So reality doesn't need anything to happen. And then you realize that everything is perfectly okay right now. This is the shift into the vision of oneness. When you first get called up to the big leagues, you're going to lay low. Yeah. Just, you know, glad to be here, sit in the corner. Stay out of the way. Now I realize what the, those who, you know, really know what they're talking about, what the basis of it is. I realize the basis of it. But I'm still, like, shaking in continuity fear. You know, continuity fear is still here. And I'm trembling and shaking inside, and it's just like, because it was very, very intense to get to this point where you feel like your storyline has failed and will never succeed, and then you shift your attention, you realize it doesn't have to succeed. There's no need for success. Reality doesn't need success. Doesn't need any storylines at all. Doesn't not need them either. No preference. So, I've done a couple of videos about the end times, and just finished another one, end times, third strike. There's something coming for sure, soon, maybe in August. Some have put it in the beginning of August, actually. That's possible. It's coming soon. Very soon. And what the purpose of all this stuff that's coming in the end times is to reset the storylines, to shuffle the deck, because there's a realization, the ego feels we're starting to get it. We're starting to catch on, actually. Saying, hey, wait a minute. All these storylines, you know, do I really have to pay attention to this? And then what does the ego do? It comes riding in. And it causes chaos and turmoil and upheaval, and all the storylines get reset, right? And it causes intrigue. You become intrigued. It's like an accident, a huge accident. Aren't we all intrigued by that? You know, the Malaysian plane and all the people. I'm not really intrigued by it, no. I'm not looking at the pictures of it. I'm not really intrigued by it, no. But most are. Most are intrigued. Wow, you know, sudden shift of storylines. Well, just imagine, you know, a world at war. And this is a different war than World War One and World War Two. This is a situation where there's just all sorts of different weaponry. Also, it's just storylines are just being blown up and shuffled in the most incredible ways. It's like a total shuffling of the deck. And we all think, hey, maybe if we shuffle the deck, something is going to have some meaning. Some of these storylines is finally going to see some meaning to it. So that's why it's going to happen. At least, it is certainly intended to happen. It doesn't absolutely have to happen. This moment here does not determine the future. Just as this moment has not been determined by the future, actually, but the attention, wanting to keep the attention on the storylines because of the continuity fear, and not working on the continuity fear virtually guarantees it. But there's always the possibility of the world deciding they're going to work on the continuity fear in some indirect way somehow. And they could back away from, you know, shuffling the deck here. Or what do wouldn't hold my breath about that. Major stuff does happen here. 9/11 happened. Fukushima happened. The Indonesian tsunami happened. The Gulf oil spill happened. The tsunami in the Philippines. The super typhoon in the Philippines. Leyte area happened. Tacloban. You don't hear much about that. That was like an incredible disaster. Incredible disaster. Major stuff has been happening starting, in 2001. It's been happening. And you've got to think that the worst is yet to come. For sure. For sure. This is just a warm-up. The reshuffling is going to get going in earnest now, soon. Okay. So, it's super important in the world to have those who realize that the reshuffling is much ado about absolutely nothing. And view the world simply as a play of light. Just a play of light. No purpose. Reality doesn't have a purpose. Reality does not have a plan. Reality is not creating souls and putting them on evolutionary journeys, anything like that. No, it's not like that. Reality is always expanding through overflowing of joy, just sheer joy and exuberance of the joy. And there's a feeling, this adventurous spirit of joy. There's no plan. Reality doesn't need any plan. Doesn't need any plan. No storyline to reality. There's no storyline. There's no blueprint. So the fabled peace beyond understanding, the fabled absolute stillness, it's definitely there. It is there when the attention shifts. And you no longer pay any attention to the plot in this world at all. It's not that you don't see the world. You do, but you see it now as just a play of light. Without any good or bad to it, actually. There is absolutely a total basis for the vision of oneness, for dropping all the storylines equally, and then realizing that everyone right now is 100% within reality entirely, and has always been and can never get outside of it, or ever have to struggle with anything that's outside of reality. There's nothing to struggle with, actually. There is no struggle. Except for the continuity fear. That's the thing. Except for the continuity fear, which is a pragmatic struggle. That is a problem. So identify, be sure to identify what the real struggle is. And then the others, you realize, no, this is not a struggle. But the continuity is a fear, is a struggle. And you get help with that from the Holy Spirit, from the grace of God, from the inner teacher, from the inner knowing, from the spiritual intuition, the voice of reason. You get it from the great teachers, from the great saviors, our savior, if you want to say it that way. The one is all one. There's only just the oneness. There isn't segments to it. It's all just the one. So there is only one way. There's only the one. How could there be an outside to that or something? No, different. The one is the one way. Oneness is the one way. The vision of oneness is the one way. How you get to that, how you evaporate your continuity fear, it could be infinite ways, actually. And it is infinite ways, because everyone's unique. Wherever you find help, help is welcome. That is for sure. So it seems like we're in shutter mode. If you see what's coming, you can't help but be shuddering. And now you wonder, why don't the people know what's coming? What's going on? How come they're not deciding to, no, we don't want this? They do want it. See, on the surface of this world, the people all seem rational enough, right? You go to the grocery store and everyone seems, well, quasi-rational. but they look sort of brittle. Underneath, they're feeling like their storyline isn't working. It's not working, and they're worried about it. Everybody's actually very worried about their situation. Their storyline just doesn't seem to be doing the job. Of course, because there is nothing to attain. So how can it, there is no attainment. So how can the storyline be reaching attainment? Cannot. As I said, it can't even reach enlightenment. There is no way to, there is no attainment in reality. So they're feeling like, wow, I feel like I'm stuck in these stories and it's just not working for me. I need a reset. I need a shuffling of the deck. And so underneath there, everyone's in like collaboration with what's to take place here. They're all agreeing, so you know what? This looks like a pretty good way to go. It's ignorance. It's ignorance. It's not a good way to go. Constantly shuffling storylines is not the good way to go. That's why success often comes in realizing there is no realization. Where someone is just sitting in the same place all the time and just they're not pursuing other storylines really. Just say, wow, I'm just stuck in this storyline forever. How can I really be free of this? And they're not jumping around like butterflies and moving around and constantly say, maybe that flower over there. Oh, there's another flower. Oh, let me go try this flower. Buzzing like bees, just going after the pollen everywhere. That's just constantly shifting the storylines, thinking that, trying to not feel the sense of this isn't working. So by just staying put wherever you are, you then gotta really dig down deep, and it's tough. It is tough for sure, but it's the best deal going. And then you see this. No storylines are needed, not even my own storyline. I never needed a storyline. Nobody ever needed a storyline. Reality doesn't need a storyline to it. Now granted, this is very heavy, heavy, heavy teaching, or sharing, as I like to put it. Because it takes two. You know, if you're sharing something with someone, they get it. You know, you can't share unless there's somebody receptive to the sharing. So, but we need this type of really deep to get the root out before they try to root out everyone that they don't like in this world, to shuffle the deck, to really radically alter the storylines. You must realize that those in charge, for instance, of the United States, are radicals. Okay? Super, super radicals. Their goal is to reset the storylines, to radically change the storylines. And there are many, many around the world in places, positions of great power now and influence, that are extreme radicals. That means they believe that their salvation will come through radically shifting and changing the storylines. a skunk is a skunk. Don't think a skunk doesn't have the, you know, the terrible smell. It does. Don't think a tiger is going to change its stripes. It's not going to change its stripes. They're no good guys or good girls in the places of power in the world. They're those who usually, by and large, aim at shifting storylines because they know that's what keeps them in power. Demagoguery. Hey, I'm going to shift your storyline. It's going to be so much better. But they're really aiming for such a massive shift in storylines. People will be so confused and so desperate to grab a hold of the right storyline that they will grab a hold of the demagogues and there they will become these quasi-godlike, goddess-like entities. Don't think that won't happen. Absolutely, it's been set up to happen. Everyone thinks in the world, they think that they're almost got it. They think they've almost reached the attainment. But the fact is, there is no attainment. So how many of us can realize there is no realization? That's the goal, actually. Now, you know, this, I'm blinking my eye, this causes double take, triple take. The brain is just saying, what? Structure, our cognitive, perceptual, personality, egoic structure. It's like, what? The whole purpose of our whole structure is attainment. And then you realize there is no attainment. This causes the shaking and trembling that I've been going through. The whole body is like quivering. It's just like, you know, wow. The whole structure is trembling. There is no attainment. There's nothing to attain. So this brings one to the wow scenario very quickly. Then having to manage that. My heart just skipped a beat, you know, I just... Sitting with a genuinely non-realized adept, so to speak, the one who has realized that, you know, no attainment, is... This is what you do, you just get sit quietly and get used to that. But it's a tremendous stress. Just because we're sitting quietly doesn't mean we're not stressed. And as a matter of fact, I would say one way to encapsulate sitting quietly, sitting still, being patient, is so that you do not try to translate your breakthroughs and insights, etc., into action. Do not translate them into action, especially immediate action. This is the discipline. As you're sitting here, you're having these just incredible insights, and you're thinking, how do I translate it into action? Don't think that way. So if you're committed to sitting quietly, sitting still, not moving your body, not doing anything with your body, then the mind just says, oh, what's the use? You know, Why even think about that? I know that I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. So forget, I'm not going to think about it. It's a huge advantage if you commit to sitting quietly. It's a gigantic advantage because once you place the commitment there, the mind gradually just gives up, says, I'm not even going to even bother thinking about how to translate this into anything. How do you translate perfect non-attainment or non-perfect non-attainment? There's no perfection to it. There's no attainment to it. How do you translate that into music, for instance? You cannot. How do you translate it into any action? You cannot. Everything is a storyline. Any appearance is a storyline, actually. We think it is. Actually, it's no story at all. There is no story. There's nothing that maybe this is it, maybe this is it, maybe this is it. Even a song, you're following along. Maybe this is it, maybe. There's no song to it. There's no song. There's no action to it. There's no action to non-attainment. There's no act of non-attainment. There's nothing to act out. Nothing to act out. So you have sitting quietly, it's still another benefit of that is when you realize there's nothing to act out, you say, not a problem, I'm used to not acting out anything anyway. So, not a problem. So it's a win-win. Sitting still is a win-win situation. The mind just sort of gives up trying to then think about action, and you're already practiced at realizing there's nothing to act out. That realization can dawn upon you and say, that's fine, I'm used to that, it's not a problem. Whereas if you're a super active person, how could you stand the realization there's nothing to act out? How's that possible? You would look at that as like you're in annihilation or something if you're a real active person. But if you're like me, who's been more less and less active, the notion of there's nothing to act out, there's no attainment to act out, no enlightenment to act out, I say it's not a problem. These great adepts in religious spiritual practice traditions, the reason why these traditions are so helpful is they have certain standards where you have to commit to these standards. And these standards are incredibly helpful. If you commit to meditation standards of not moving your body, for instance, then you can work out so much in your mind so quickly, actually. It gives you incredible leverage. You're not going to work. You're just going to beg for alms and a little bit of rice. You're going to meditate. They commit to these commitments. And that just gives you huge, huge, huge advantage. But we can do similar. Commit to sitting still. Don't act on anything. Have a period of time where you're not going to act on anything and you're committed to it. This is when the breakthroughs occur. Easy. Don't say, well, I don't know, I might, you know, to go somewhere, I might do something, I might. No mites. No mites about it. No, we're just not going to do anything except just sit here like this. Like a rock. Like a stone. Not trying to be a stone, but that's just a, you know, metaphor for it. Just no struggle, but we're just not going to act anything out. If the winning lottery numbers come to us, we're not going to do anything about it. We're not going to rush down to the store. No, doesn't matter what comes to us. So this is the commitment. This is the commitment that the great meditators make. And then all of these temptations and things, they're able to cut through all of them because they say, look, no matter what arises within me, I'm not going to act anything out. Now, eventually, they get to higher levels where they commit to not acting anything out at a higher level, actually, in their mind. And then they go into, you know, these great states of, you know, nirvana and various tremendous states of, and even higher commitments. And then they cut through all of even the subtle storylines. They cut through all the storylines. We're just working to cut through the storyline here in this world, mostly. And we can go deeper too. But one can see what a huge benefit it is to have a tradition of meditative practice, actually. No wonder that there's been success that way. Trying to do it outside of tradition is very difficult. It can be done. It can be done. And there are many who do it that way. But at least have to be smart about the situation and make this practice commitment. Not a commitment like I'm going to do a certain amount of time, because then you're thinking about, okay, when's the time up? When's the time up? Now, this is just an open-ended commitment. I'm just going to sit here and see what happens. That's it. I want to see how far I can get. Let me see if maybe I can get all the way. I'm just going to do the best I can. It's like that. I'm just going to do the best I can. It's not about earning any sort of prestige or academic degree or be elevated in any sort of hierarchy or anything. It's actually trying to succeed. The problem with institutionalizing anything is you get institutionalists and bureaucrats and spiritual bureaucrats who are simply saying, how long do I have to meditate? How many years? And they just put in the time. And they say, okay, I did it for 3 years. Okay, I deserve a position here. They're like academics. Looking for tenure, spiritual tenure. That gets you nowhere. Gets you nowhere. It's like taking a class and they say, well, what do I need to do to pass this class? I need to get some, you know, just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Whereas the ones who are really serious, they put so much into the class, they realization comes, I don't even need the class. I don't even need this at the school. I don't need a degree. I don't need anything. I don't need any storyline. I don't need any success. Nobody needs any success. Reality doesn't need success. Reality doesn't need success. Reality doesn't need success. Shaking and trembling, and there's just, this is so profound that the expression doesn't know if it could really express it. But again, maintain the discipline. Don't act it out in any way. Don't go say, wow, I need to go do some yoga. Go running off to your yoga class. Oh, I need to get into my yoga clothes, get my yoga equipment, get into the yoga mood, run down to the yoga class, do the yoga, yada, 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 everybody. No, don't even think that. You know you're not moving, so those thoughts simply just get short-circuited. Not moving like this actually short-circuits most thought. This is what I'm finding out. This is what most meditators find out, and I'm really in awe of meditators, you know, how they've been able to do that. It's just incredible. What an accomplishment, or what a much respect to the meditators. Because if you keep doing it and keep doing it, it really does short circuit your thoughts. Most thoughts are thoughts of action, right? Getting, attaining something, right? Almost all thoughts. If you're just sitting here doing nothing, not thinking, not acting on anything at all, it seems to short circuit almost all thoughts, and then the ones that are left are the thoughts of the Holy Spirit. And this is when you have the breakthroughs. There's no goal in meditation. Don't set a goal. And just, it's just sitting quietly and seeing if some breakthroughs will emerge. And they do. You keep your attention on it. And then managing your success. I tell you, though, the ancient people really, really knew a lot. They knew more than we do, actually, about salvation. They knew more, way more. They didn't need the wheel. They did not need the wheel. They had the spiritual technology. They understood it a lot. Many great ancient traditions. So what happened was on July 17th, the morning of, I spent the whole morning in bed till late, and I think it was the 17th, or maybe it was the 18th, Anyway, doesn't matter. I kept my mind quiet for so long, not moving, for so many hours, that gradually everything cleared up, began to get clearer and clearer and clearer. And then I was able to see this. See so much. Because all the other thoughts had been short-circuited and were not arising. Then I was able to see the situation as it is. See? You know, actually, people can do this meditation in various ways. Like truck drivers, drivers can go into very much a meditative state. Earn money at the same time. They just know I'm just sitting here like this for the next 12 hours, right? Like, so there is no question of doing anything else other than this. This short circuits a ton of thoughts in their mind. Now, the autopilot thoughts of driving are, but that's rudimentary. So certainly truck drivers can be, you know, greatly helped, and people who are just sitting quietly knowing that that's what they're going to be doing can absolutely use that as a meditation. I find it extremely difficult to be clear and see the situation as it is when I'm active. Seems to be impossible. As a matter of fact, when I'm active, all sorts of negative thoughts arise. And I get pulled into all the storylines and all the drama and intrigue and deception and backbiting. Horrible. Like, all of a sudden, where do those terrible thoughts come from? And the action brings those up. Like watching action movies, action, all this action television. Very bad. I've noticed that, very bad for my psyche. They should have television stations where meditation, where people just sit quietly like this. And people can say, hey, I'm just gonna sit quietly. It works like a miracle. Works like a miracle, actually. Housewives or whoever's staying at home can certainly, you know, when their tasks are done for a while, they can say, I'm going to just sit quietly from 11 to 1 o'clock or whatever every day, and just like a stone, I'm just going to pay attention to clarity that arises. One day they could absolutely make the shift of attention and recognize recognize the non-attaining nature of reality. Sure. Anyone can do it. Stay away from all the action. Just take time out. Take a time out from the action. I've been meditating. I never called it meditation. I still don't. I would say I've never meditated in my life. I never thought of it that way. But for 36 years, very intensely. But again, I never thought of myself any sort of practitioner of anything. Just simply desire, thirst, hunger for that which I knew is present. I just couldn't seem to attain it because there is no attaining it. We keep thinking we need to finish the path, and the way we finish it is through attainment. You never finish the path through attainment. It only ends in non-attainment. The realization of the perfect non-attainment nature of reality. There's nothing to attain. Reality does not need to attain anything. So, you know, the fortunate ones who actually take the time to be quiet and still, you know, those are the heavyweights. Again, I'm always in awe. I feel like a super lightweight, actually. I feel like I'm just don't even hardly deserve any mention in any way, really. Maybe no, none. That's how I look at my situation. It seems like there's so many who are so, you know, way more adept and that's how it appears to me. So every day I feel like I have to overachieve in terms of whatever I do. It requires tremendous overachievement, and even then it's not even close to good enough. Maybe that's being number two son. I think that puts you in that kind of situation where you, no matter what you do, you feel that you're way behind. That's how I've always felt. And they say, what's that car commercial used to be? Was it Avis Hertz or Avis? It was one of them too. We try harder. You know, we have to try harder. We're number two, and we've got to try harder to please you. And we are always trying to catch up to number one. Where they say number one can rest on their laurels, but number two really has to try. And so, you know, that's how I felt my whole life. I have to, no matter how much I put into it, it's insufficient. It's not good enough. But I keep trying. I said, wow, I just got to try to catch up. And that drives one, I guess, to put in tremendous hours and time every day. Can't skip a day. You feel like you're way behind. How can you skip a day? There is no arrival. The realization, there is no arrival. There's nowhere to arrive at. You cannot arrive at reality, in reality. So the end of the path is the no end, the no arrival, the non-reaching. The failure of the path, the failure of all paths. There's nothing to get, so the path of getting is nothing. It just always was just a play of light, a purposeless, meaningless play of light, just appearances. All appearances are one condition. The condition of appearances. All appearances are simply the condition of appearances. Just one condition of appearances. All appearances. They're all equally the same. Just a play of light. Everything's just a play of light. There's only one condition of appearances. Play of light. No real purpose there at all. Just an expression of our joy, our desire. You ever see a dog look at a treat? They're motionless, right? They're just like totally fixed on it. What does that do? It blocks out all their thoughts. All our thoughts of action are not present at all, right? We have a cat. The cat is gets very intent if it's looking at something that it's super interested in. And it's just totally focused on that. Not moving. Utterly still. And you can go up to it and kind of, you know, hey, it doesn't really see you, your hand or anything. And when its concentration is broken, the guy goes, oh, startled, like, oh, who's there? Because all its thoughts are just simple. Everything's simplified into, that is what I want right there. So So what we want is the realization of non-realization. The path of no path. The bliss of no bliss. The attainment of no attainment. The enlightenment of no enlightenment. The condition of no condition. And so by sitting quietly like this, you can actually recognize this. Whereas if you start moving around, you cannot. It's very very difficult. That's why the ones who can actually move around and still remain in this absolute stillness are, that's very great. They have shed their continuity fear to an extraordinary extent. Very rare to see those, very rare. I've never seen one in this world. I know there have been some, I know of them, but I have not personally, I've not met them, I've been in their presence here in the world. So most of us have to sit quietly. And don't worry about all the scary stories of this and this and that. You're not going anywhere or acting anything out anyway. You're not taking action on that anyway, so short circuit right there. I find looking into this video monitor on this little camera very helpful, actually. Because I'm watching myself and monitoring myself, making sure I don't get distracted. Now, I'm not looking intently at myself or anything, but I'm aware. Diffusely aware, peripherally aware. Is helpful. If you want to use your dumb phone a certain way, put your camera on your dumb phone or your picture and put it on a tripod in front of you so you can see yourself as you're sitting still, and just do it that way. I mean, that's the best use for the dumb phones there is, for sure. I've just invented the greatest app in history. That is true. What I do is I just keep the monitor basically in front of me. My eyes are not, I try not to go off of it. I'm not really looking at any expression or anything. It's there. It's a point of focus, actually, an area of focus. I don't make any conscious effort at it, but it just works that way. So, again, the greatest app in history has just been invented here in the Silicon Valley for the dumb phone. There will never be a better one. This is breaking news, folks. Put the dumb phone on a tripod in front of you, of your chair, wherever you're sitting. Put it on video or camera function. I think camera function will show you on the screen, right? And just leave it on. You have it plugged into a power source if you want to, or the batteries last a long time. I don't know how long with a screen on like that, but maybe hours and hours. And just, there you go. Just start sitting still. You're not taking any action. is not, don't try to make a goal like I'm sitting still. It's more like I'm just committed to not taking any action here. I'm just going to not take any action, act on anything. Act on, so what is today, 19th? 19th of July, the greatest app in the history of the planet has just been invented here by Clarity Ross for all dumb phones. And you can, if you have a video camera, you can do that too, or even a camera, you can use it that way. It's, you'll find it super helpful, super helpful. Once you stop being self-conscious about it, now that I'm talking about it, I'm thinking about it, become self-conscious about it. Of course, you don't want that, but that'll drop away. Don't worry, you just get used to it. It's a great day. Greatest invention in the history of the world has just happened. Because the most important thing in the world is this quiet sitting, actually short-circuiting all these thoughts of action, storyline thoughts. So you're able to see the actual situation of the storyline, of the path, of the fact, of your attention, ability to shift it and realize there's nothing outside, there's nothing that needs to come in from outside. The path doesn't need to get anywhere. The path doesn't need to get anywhere. No path needs to get anywhere. To realize that is the goal of our existence here. So to use the dumb phone to help you do that is the greatest invention. It's a greater invention than the wheel. I guess I did something. Oh, thanks. All thanks to the Holy Spirit. All thanks to sitting quietly. Yeah, I'm not joking at all either. I mean, this is absolutely true. This is way more important than the wheel. Whatever it is that you have that can help you, and since so many people have these dumb phones, and they're so addicted to them, this is the way to use it. You see, this is the way to be smart. It's no longer a dumb phone, it's a smartphone now. You finally turned it into a smartphone. Congratulations. See, I don't need the dumb smartphone because I have this video camera. So I said, I don't need it. If I had one, I'd use it that way, I'm sure. That's pretty much all I'd use it for. Maybe check the weather occasionally. I tend to be obsessive in checking the weather. So I don't want a smartphone, a dumb phone. It gets addictive, checking the weather. See, I think about 3 o'clock, the wind is supposed to pick up to about, 12 miles an hour. And I'm checking the radar patterns. There's a slight cloud pattern coming in. It should be here in about an hour. You know, it's coming in from the south. I tend to get like that. Okay, I think the temperature's going to drop by like 2 degrees. Or at 4 o'clock, I see it's going to be a weather change, pressure change. There's going to be some wind. And just get minutely interested in the weather or anything that can happen. So stay away from that. I don't want the ability to check on stuff. I absolutely do not want it. Because that's action, 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 action. I don't want action. I want this inaction. See, the mind knows I'm not going to act anything out, so it just is quiet. It just sits there. It's gradually just adjusted to it. Even stuff going on around the neighborhood, I'm not reacting. I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to react. I'm not going to try to help somebody out. Take interest in anything. No, nothing. I'm not going to do anything. So that the mind just stops. It doesn't try to develop any storyline. and by not developing any storyline, your attention path that all paths are pathless. Now, if you are taking action, you'll have absolutely no idea what that means. If I take action, I'd have no idea what it means. Go to the market, I'm just another fool. I have no idea. I said, an hour ago was I in this, you know, very clear state. Are you kidding me? What are you talking about? That can't be possible, can it? It's like that. So, what's the benefit? Well, when all hell is breaking loose around us, we still sit still and quiet. I'm not taking any action. I'm committed to not taking any action. Remember, this is not a sitting still contest at all. There are no rules or regulations, you know, you could... It's just... You're not going to act anything out. Just commit it. You just... It's a feeling that I'm staying committed here. I want to succeed. I want this burden to drop off, drop away. I want to see there is no such thing as success. So maybe I might finally be qualified to at least meditate, or I get some help with a meditation teacher or something. That's possible. Because I can see there's room for, you know, deepening the realization, to realize there is no depth to reality. So my greatest, you know, great hope is I may get some help, but I'm not counting on it. I just don't know. I am counting on it, but I really don't. I'm not going to act on anything right now anyway, so there you go. The thoughts quiet down. Again, much respect to the traditions of the great meditators. I'm seeing their wisdom now. They sit quietly like this no matter what. And it doesn't matter if the king comes or the queen or whatever. They're not done with their quiet sitting. They're not moving or doing anything. And all society respects those people. That's the great advantage of tradition, a tradition a place with great spiritual meditative tradition is so respected that nobody demands that you spring into action. Ananda Maima would go around to all these great meditators, and the steward, someone taking care of where the meditator was, the household or whatever, caretaker. They'd say, "We're glad you're here, but they're meditating. You'll have to wait." She waited. She'd wait. But what happened is the meditator would say, would realize, there's an opportunity to sit with one who is you can't even say it in words. The one who does not have any need whatsoever. I was completely free of all delusion entirely. So they see that, well, that's a great opportunity. So then they sit and they meditate for several hours. Like that. But they don't break their meditation for anyone. Not even for God. They would not break their meditation. Not at first. And then they realize, hey, here's a great opportunity. I'll even have a better meditation. But that's the culture, you see. And then they'd say, I hope, it's okay with you. I didn't break my meditation. And she'd say, it's fantastic. That's fantastic. That's what I was looking for. That's what I was looking for, She says, don't break your meditation for anyone, for any reason whatsoever. That's a culture of attainment there, or rather non-attainment. The attainment of non-attainment, the realization reality has no needs, reality doesn't need anything to happen. Reality doesn't need anything to happen. Reality doesn't need anything to happen. There are no happenings in reality whatsoever. Process, something tied together, some reaching, some attaining, some effect like that. No, there's no happenings at all. It's just a play of light. Nothing happens to light. Light cannot make anything happen to itself, and everything's the play of light. So how can there be any happenings? There's only the joyful experiencing. The spontaneous, overflowing expansion of joy, experiencing some people get up and play around a round of golf every morning, retired people. Why don't they get up and spend 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours sitting quietly? So at some point you realize that you're starting to, you can sort of feel that the effort is coming to an end. Which is fine. Which is fine. You see, it's a natural thing. You don't time yourself. The very thought of timing just puts shudders through me. Completely interferes with it, in my opinion. It's not time and action. Isn't the whole thing then just an exercise and action? Absolutely, at some level it is. I struggle with the Course in Miracles, the exercises, because I couldn't stand the idea, so try to do it for 5 minutes, do it for 10 minutes, every hour, try it on the hour. I just couldn't do it. To live in like in a timeless state of just, doesn't matter what time it is, day or night, not paying attention to what time it is so much, clock, whatever, doesn't matter. Whenever you rest and then you go back and you make more effort, you rest, you go back and make more effort, that's it. Don't need to think about anything, how many days I've been doing it, how long, how much time I put into it today. No, forget it, don't keep track of anything, just rest, and then when you get some more effort, energy to do it, do it. Just do it again, and then you get tired, rest, and just do it again. That's it. Don't be a spiritual accountant. Now, you can know just vaguely, you know, well, I've been doing it. If I force myself, I can think, well, yeah, I started, blah, blah, blah. But I really was doing it before then, too. This is my whole life I've been doing it, actually. Creative people who do the arts, creative arts. When I was a creative artist in my previous life, I had to have tremendous discipline. You run out of ideas. You have to be able to sit quietly at times and just wait. They call it the muse. But what happens is the thoughts start being short-circuited, and you're able to then see more clearly. At a superficial level, very superficial. Art is actually at a very superficial level, believe it or not. I've known great artists, you know, world-renowned artists, very superficial. But that discipline can be an ally. So. Everybody has some allies, actually. Whether you're a truck driver, or an artist, or housewife, or whatever, you have allies. Use your allies. See, it's all about being expedient, pragmatic and expedient and smart. Use your allies to assist you. And stay away from your detractors. Detractors will try to tempt you into action. They'll try to goad you into action, trick you into action, to get these thoughts flowing, which then you then feel like you're outside, there's something outside, right? The storyline, something about outside, and then you're easily controllable if by the people who are manipulators. It's easy for them to control you. So stay away from your detractors, those who goading you into action that you don't need to take, don't want to take, don't need to take, actually. Having never considered myself a meditator at all, I don't see how it's possible I could ever join any sort of meditative tradition or anything. I wouldn't know what to do. You know, I'd be an idiot. I must be doing it all wrong. I'm reminded of that story where the bishop visits, heard some, there's some monks out on an island, and they've heard that they've forgotten the correct way to say this rite. And so the bishop says, wow, that's not good. They're going to go to hell. I better go out and help them out. The bishop takes a boat out to the island, gets to the island, meets with the monks, and they says, you know, hey, monks, tell me how you say this prayer. And they say, and the bishop says, whoa, wait a minute. There's a couple of words there were not right. Says, here, let me fix it for you. Let me tell you what the correct form of the prayer is. And so the bishop told them the prayer, and they said, wow, bishop, thank you so much. That's great. Thank you for coming all the way out here and setting us straight. We're so appreciative of that. You know, the bishop says, okay. And so the bishop then gets in the boat, and the bishop is going across the bay to the mainland. And the bishop hears some commotion and hears his name being called. And says, hey, bishop, please, your eminence, please. Wait. Bishop says, who's calling me out in the middle of this bay? You know, what is this? He turns around and he sees the monks running across the bay toward the boat. And the monks run up to the bishop. And the bishop's sitting in the boat in the water, and the monks are standing on the water. And the monks say, hey, bishop, we got a big problem. Got a big problem. And the bishop says, he's totally freaked out, says, what? And the monks say, yeah, you know, I know you came out here and you told us the right form and everything was great, but we forgot. We forgot. And the bishop says, don't worry about it. And the monks went running back to the island, and the bishop went back to the mainland. Don't worry about it. I feel I'm getting like called up to the big league club, and like Willie Mays is on the team, you know. I'm petrified. Are you kidding? I mean, I don't know how I could do that. If like Willie Mays is on the baseball team and I was being called up to be on that team, I don't know how I could possibly show my face in the dugout. Probably just ignore him for the first year. Couldn't even say hi, you know. Because I realize, you know, this I'm like nothing, you know, compared to Willie Mays. No matter how good I am, I'm like nothing. I just have to say, Mr. Mays, yeah. It's a great, great honor. It's a great honor. I hope that I can at least soak in a little bit. Yeah, just think of what an opportunity that is. You get called up and Willie Mays is playing center field for you. And you get to watch him all the time. It's like too much of an honor. Just using a crude analogy here, but you know. Being overly honored, you know, that kind of thing. I'd probably be shaken for months. Because no matter how good you get, you're never going to be that good. Not really. Ultimately, you know, never say never, right? But for practical purposes. So have that feeling, you know, like you're going to get called up to the big team, and make sure you're ready for it. Make sure you're ready for it. That's a great meditation. Great meditation. Just feel the pressure. Put the pressure on yourself. Use whoever you want. You're going to see Jesus. You're going to sit with Jesus. Just imagine you're sitting with Jesus in a room or whatever. Just imagine that. Could you even do that? You know, It's completely mind-blowing. That's a great meditation. Great meditation. Just burns you. The best way is just be absolutely still. If Jesus is walking towards you, just be absolutely still. You're on the Mount of Olives, you're the multiplication of the fish and loaves of bread. You're one of multitudes. As we walking towards you, just remain absolutely still. And say, I'm not going to break my stillness for any reason. Say that's the right way to do it. Commit to that. Commit to it. That's the ticket. That's the ticket. All right. Very great. Wind down on this video here. Very intense times we're in, and but you're here. You might as well embrace the times. Might as well embrace it. We're all here now. Might as well embrace it. Just got to embrace it. Do what's necessary. Do what's necessary. Do the non-doing, which is necessary. Okay. All right, great. That's it.